G'day, Chris here, and welcome back to Clickspring. In this video, the gear train of the clock starts to take shape as I make the wheel collets and the other arbors. This barrel arbor that was completed in a previous video is kind of a special type of arbor. The rest of the arbors look more like this, long and thin and usually with a thin pin-like extension at each end, called a pivot, which rotates in the clock frame. The wheels are mounted on these arbors using what clockmakers call a collet, which is basically a mounting flange with a hole through the middle. There's a raised boss section that locates the wheel by its bore, and screws are used to fasten the wheel in place. Now the centre wheel collet is a little different from the others, in that it has a pivot built into its profile. And to make that pivot last a little longer when the clock is in service, I'll be making this collet from drill rod. The other two collets are just simple wheel mountings, so they'll be made from brass. For materials, I'm making the collets from this rod stock, and the arbors will be made from pivot steel. Pivot steel is a high carbon steel that's been hardened and then tempered to blue. It's tough, but it can still be machined, and it's reasonably straight as supplied from the manufacturer. So let's get started. There are some key features of the clock where concentricity is quite important, and the wheel work is a great example. What I'd like to see at the end of the process is a set of wheel assemblies that rotate on their pivots with minimal runout at the tooth perimeter. Now to achieve that, I'll be turning the profile of the collets in the lathe, but I'll be leaving the critical dimensions a little bit oversized. Once the heavy cuts for the stock removal have been completed, I'll mount the collets on their respective arbors and then take some light finishing cuts between centers to true up all of the critical surfaces. So the first step was to get the collets into basic shape, and they're each formed in essentially the same way. The central bore needs to be a good fit on the arbor, so after drilling out most of the metal, I used a reamer made from the actual arbor stock the collet will be mounted on to bring the hole to final size. Click on the link if you'd like to see how that was made. So that's all three collets roughed out and ready to be turned to final dimension later. Next I made a start on the arbor pivots, and there are three key features to be formed: the pivot itself, the domed end, and the chamfered shoulder. Now pivots need to be concentric with the outside diameter of the stock, which makes them an ideal candidate for turning on a small lathe equipped with 8mm collets. The stock can pass all the way through the headstock of the lathe, and with a good set of collets, the runout can be quite low. Now the features of the pivot can be formed using a standard fixed cutting tool, but it's also quite common to form them using a handheld graver, which is what I'm going to do today. These gravers have been made from high-speed steel blanks, and the cutting edges have been formed on a standard grinding wheel. In fact, there's a great DVD by the American clockmaker Bill Smith showing exactly how to do this. I'll put a link to it in the description box below. And I've mentioned before how much I enjoy hand turning on the lathe, but the beauty of the graver, apart from it being fun to use, is that it makes the process of forming pivots so quick. A graver cuts the hardened steel surprisingly well, and a pivot can be turned in a matter of minutes. After cutting the profile, I stoned the pivot surface with a fine oilstone and then finished it off with a burnisher. The burnishing work hardens the surface and gives it a longer service life. The final feature to put in is the chamfer on the edge, which will reduce the shoulder friction with the plate when it's in operation. As I completed one pivot on each arbor, I used the clock frame itself to determine the shoulder length to the other pivot. I pushed the completed shoulder hard up against one plate and then marked off the other shoulder location with a small allowance subtracted for end shake. The second pivot on each arbor was then formed in the same way as the first. I used some fine emery paper followed by diamantine paste to remove the blue oxide from the pivot steel and leave a good polished surface. So now that the arbors are complete, the collets can be bonded into place with a spot of Loctite 603. Each of the collets were then turned between centres to be a close fit with their corresponding wheels, and all other surfaces were taken to final dimension. And while it was being conveniently held, I also gave the centre arbor pivot surface a stone and burnish. Next, I need to drill the mounting holes for the wheels. And to position the holes, the wheels themselves can be used as a drilling template. First, the hole locations were marked out on this wheel crossing jig. The holes were then given a good starting point with a spade drill and then drilled the tapping drill size for 10BA screws. Each wheel was then placed on the collet seating and a single hole drilled and tapped in the collet. The wheel was then fastened into place using a commercial screw, and the other tapping holes were drilled, using the wheel holes as a drilling template. The remaining two holes were tapped and all surfaces deburred with a light touch from a twist drill. Now the process was essentially the same for all three wheels, although there were some minor differences between them. The escape wheel needs this little spacer between the wheel and pinion, so after spotting the locations, the holes were opened up using the finger plate tool to hold the work. And the length of the centre arbor makes it necessary to come up with a way to reach down past the end of the arbor to do the cutting. Wilding suggests making these simple tap and drill extenders, and they work great. I took quite a bit of care as I was making the drill extender to keep the runout of the drill to a minimum, so it still holds position really well. And the feel from the tap extender is just excellent for controlling a small tap. A set of 10 BA screws were turned to size and then hardened, polished and blued. And that's all of the parts complete, so let's put it all together. In the next episode, I'll finish off the barrel assembly, and you'll also get to see the wheels rotating in the frames for the first time as I depth and plant the gear train. Thanks for watching. I'll see you later. If you enjoyed this video, then here's two more that I think you might like. And I do appreciate it when you give the video a thumbs up and leave me a comment. If you'd like to know when the next video is released, be sure to subscribe. And if you'd like to help support the creation of these videos, then head on over to the Clickspring Patreon page. Thanks again for watching. I'll catch you on the next video.